Welcome students. Today we are going to cover group behavior and conflict management topics in organizational behavior. Let us start up with the introduction of group. Firstly, what do we understand by groups? Two or more individuals interacting and interdependent who have come together to achieve particular objectives. So if two people come together for a common goal, for the achievement of common goal, that can be termed as groups. Here we can very well differentiate between the leading group and teams. When we talk about teams, the team members are already the members who are motivated and are committed towards the goal. Whereas when we talk about groups, they are people who have just come together to work and to achieve an objective. So they might not be that motivated and committed to the goal. Why people join groups? This is another issue which we have to discuss here. What are the reasons and what are the benefits out of it? The first reason is security. That is, the groups reduce insecurity of standing alone, feel stronger, fewer self-doubts and more resistant to threats. So it gives a sense of security to be a part of a group. Status. When we talk about status, it is inclusion in a group viewed by outsiders as important and provides recognition and status. So say if you belong to a very recognized group, you enjoy the same status that of a group. Then self-esteem. It provides feelings of self-worth to group members in addition to conveying status to outsiders. So it gives you a feeling of self-confidence and a value for yourself to be part of a group. Affiliation. It fulfills social needs, enjoys regular interaction, can be primary source for fulfilling need for affiliation. So need for affiliation is when you have more requirement of being a part of a group and you feel good to be a part of a group of people and have a network with them. Power. What cannot be achieved individually often becomes possible, so power in numbers. So we can call trade unions to be groups, wherein you can say that the workers come forward to represent their interest by way of trade unions. So that is power in numbers. That's an example of how there is power in numbers. And lastly, the last reason is goal achievement. So obviously some tasks require more than one person and it need to pool in talents, knowledge or power to complete the job. In such instances, management may rely on the use of a formal group. So a formal group can be used for achievement of a goal. These are all the reasons why people join groups and what are the benefits derived out of it. Let us see how many types of groups are there. The first two categories which can be created are formal and informal groups. Where you can see here, there are two types of formal groups and two types of informal groups. When we talk about formal groups, it is command group and task group, and informal are interest groups and friendship groups. Let us understand what are these groups. The first is command group, where it's a formal group wherein you would find a leader and generally a team who would be assisting the leader or who would be taking orders from this leader and perform a task, perform a work or job. And it's a form of you know, a big group wherein the leader is identified by the group members itself, or maybe it is being formally determined by the organization structure. An example could be that of, say, a principal and school teachers. So the group of school teachers led by the principal of the school would be falling under the command groups. Next is the second formal type of group we can see is task groups, where this task group is being formed for meeting out a special purpose or for fulfilling a special task. When we talk about you know, there is one special task group which has been formed to say solving a matter of indiscipline in a college or school. So that is a task group, and as and when the purpose is covered, the goal is achieved, the group disperses. So that forms the task groups. When we talk of informal groups, we have two kinds, interest groups and friendship groups. Interest groups are those groups where people come together for a common cause, for a common interest to be met out in the organizations. For instance, like the management has thrown out a worker, and to oppose this, a group has been formed, which all of them, they believe that the worker should be called back. So that is an example of an interest group which has been formed for meeting out a common interest. Say a group of people who would come together to request for a pay hike, that is another form of interest groups. So all people sharing a common interest would form an interest group, which is not formally determined. It is like by their own interest they come together and then meet out their purposes. Then we have informal, another form of groups, that is friendship groups, wherein people of the groups, they share common hobbies, common sports, or they have something in common which they would like to come together and perform. Like they can join at the coffee breaks, and it is like the group members do have likeness for each other, and that forms the friendship groups. Now, what are the stages of group development? Every group in the organization does cross a stage, and there are various stages in this entire development process. The first one, if you can see here, the circles in the diagram, if you can see the chart here, the circles represent the members, that is the group members, and the arrows, they represent the direction of the thought. So this is the first stage, pre-stage, when some task is being given to a group and the group is recently being formed. You can see the arrows are all in different directions, and the group has no structure in this stage. So we can see here that the group members, they have come together for achieving the objectives, but right now they are very much unclear on what has to be achieved, how it has to be achieved, what is the process to be followed, who's going to be the group leader. So all these thoughts are very unclear, and thought of directions are in all different ways. So nobody or there is no alignment between the thoughts of two people or two members in that group. Then we have the stage one, the forming stage. Now at this stage, you can see the three members' thoughts are in one direction and the other two have it in different directions. So here people have started identifying themselves to be part of a group. They have come together and now they are sharing their thoughts with each other. And you can say that they are trying to find out how to perform and who is going to be the leader for the group. They are trying to identify this issue here. Then we have stage 2, the storming stage, where you can see a more clearer structure of a group. As you can see here, all the group members are interacting with each other. The arrows are all interlinked and they are all pointing towards one person, and that forms the leader of the group. So here at this stage, storming stage, the group members do have realized and have identified a leader to whom they will report, and they are going to seek suggestions before they perform any task from this particular member. Now this selection can be based on maybe the person's knowledge, skills, his abilities, his experience, and so this stage is more of a solidified structure as compared to the last two stages. Then we have stage 3, the norming stage. When we talk about the norming stage, you can see a very solid structure of a group. The leader has been identified in the last stage itself, but now you can see there are clear-cut instructions and orders from the leader, and at the same time the followers are always seeking his suggestions and they are giving the feedback to the leader. This is a stage when everything is very much clearly laid down. They have completely understood the procedures of doing the task, how to perform. So everything is very much clear here. Now after this stage, you can see the next stage, that is stage 4, and that is the performing stage. Now here you can see all the group members are performing their task. The structure is very clear. All of them are exchanging their views and they are all trying to finish their work in the given deadline. Now this performing stage becomes the last stage for permanent nature of groups. But when the nature of the groups is it's temporary, then as and when the task is being performed and the goal is being achieved, it shifts on to the stage 5, which is the adjoining stage. Now here, this stage you can say is, you can see the dotted lines over there, which represents that the group is getting disbanded. The group members are going back to their original places in the organization because the task is being accomplished. Now at this stage, there is a lot of emotional involvement as regards, you know, there are two mixed feelings which group members might have. One is that group members might feel sad about, you know, losing their friendships, and another thing is they can feel very happy on the accomplishment of the group. So with this stage, the temporary groups gets dispersed and the group members, they join their organization back and perform the routine tasks. So these are all the stages of group development. Now, what are the basic group concepts, or what are the dynamics which are being followed in a group, which actually has an impact on the nature of the group? The first thing is roles, the norms, status, cohesiveness, size and composition. The first what we call as roles is every, you know, it's to engage in a set of expected behavior patterns that are attributed to occupying a given position in a social unit. So whatever role or whatever task is being given to you in the group to perform, to be performed, or whatever position is being given to you, you have to stick to it and cover it up. So that forms the roles which are being given in a group. So actually when we talk about roles, it's more of a psychological contract, that is maybe unwritten agreement that exists between employees and the employer, and it sets out mutual expectations. So nothing as such is being written down, but it's the mutual expectations from each other which forms the roles in the group. Another is norms. Norms are actually the acceptable standards of behavior within a group that are adopted and shared by the group's members. So when, you know, it's very obvious that the group members might expect from each other a free communication and cooperation. So this is an acceptable standard of behavior which is, you know, generally expected by the group members and which are to be adhered to, because just in case if the norms are being followed, you might be singled out from the group. So that forms the norms. Then we have status, which also gives a different identity or separate identity to a group. So a socially defined position or rank given to groups or group members by others. So status is generally a rank which is being given to the group members and the group itself. What determines status? The power a person wields over others, a person's ability to contribute to group goals, and an individual's personal characteristics. All these three factors would have an impact on the status of a group, and that would determine the nature of the group. So if the person is more powerful and he has all capabilities and abilities, skills to be a leader of that group, then, you know, he might have a different status, his group might have a different status. Then how he is able to contribute to the group goals, that is another issue. And an individual's personal characteristics, that is What comprises the group, what type of people are there, that also determines the status of the group. Then we have cohesiveness. It's a degree to which the members of the group are attracted to each other and motivated to stay in the group. That is the bonding they share in between themselves and they are ready to cooperate with each other. That forms cohesiveness. And generally cohesiveness is being directly linked to productivity. So relationship of cohesiveness to productivity, you can say here is, this is how what represents the cohesiveness and productivity relationship. So one of the angles you can see is alignment of group and organizational goals and cohesiveness. If the groups are very much aligned, it is high, and the cohesiveness is high, then there will be a strong increase in productivity. If the alignment is high but the cohesiveness is low, in that situation, moderate increase in productivity. If the alignment is low and the cohesiveness is high, then again decrease in productivity because people are very unclear on goals and they have a shared form of goals, not shared but then individual goals. Then if the cohesiveness, if the alignment is very low, at the same time the cohesiveness is low, then no significant effect on productivity. So these are the four impacts on productivity which have been researched and have been put down like this. So you can see, so the best situation would be, or idealistic situation would be, where there is high alignment and at the same time high cohesiveness. So strong increase in the productivity. The next factor is size. So how size affects a group? Smaller groups are faster at completing tasks. The large groups are consistently better at problem solving because more people are there, you know, there are more ideas, more views are there, and so the problem solving can become faster. And obviously you can also delegate some work to other group members in case the group is large. Increases in group size are inversely related to individual performance. So it is said that more bigger is the size of the group, the performance of the individual is inversely affected. So the group size also matters in giving the effectivity of the group performance. Then we have composition. So when a group is diverse, there is an increased probability that it will possess the needed characteristics to complete its task effectively. So composition would mean what type or what nature, what abilities does the group member have. If they are coming from say diverse cultures or diverse educational backgrounds, then the probability is there that, you know, there would be more knowledge in that group to perform varied tasks and they would be very quick at making decisions. So that also gives a different status and adds on to the group effectiveness. It also promotes conflict and which stimulates creativity, which leads to improved decision making. Now lastly, the group behavior, we would discuss the group decision making. When we talk of group decision making, let us see the advantages of it. The first is, with group decision making, there is more diversity of views, increased information, higher quality decisions and improved commitment. So these are the advantages which are there when we take decisions in groups. If we talk about disadvantages, then it is, the first is dominant individuals. That is, there are few members in the group which are of very dominant nature, and they might try to try to dominate other group members and make them agree on their own points of interest. Then while making decision making in group, people are really unclear on the responsibility, because if one person, you cannot point out at the end of the task, if it ends up into a failure, that this person is responsible for taking the decision. So everybody has an equal responsibility in group decision making. So generally the accountability is quite low. Then group decision making consumes a lot of time, and money is also one dimension. So it might if the decision is not being taken at one meeting, you might need in several meetings, which might involve a lot of cost. Say that you have to call various executives from various places. Then we have conformity pressures. Conformity pressures is that is one of the person is dominant, so he would actually ask all others to conform on his views, to agree to his views. So that forms a bias from decision making. So these are all advantages and disadvantages of group decision making. So we can now very clearly have a difference between what the individual decision making and group decision making. Individual will be more efficient because it's going to be faster, and group would be more effective, although it will consume time, but then the goal would be achieved in a better way. The speed of individual decision making is very fast, and here it will be more information and knowledge can be given for while going in for group decision making. For individuals, no meetings are required, no discussions are required, because it has to be taken by one person. And while taken in for group decision making, diversity of views can be there, because people will give their own ideas and suggestions on an issue, and so this can form diverse views and a better decision can be taken up. Individual has clear accountability. Like we have already said, in group decision making, accountability is very unclear that who has actually taken up this decision. Then consistent values in individual decision making, because it's every time taken up by one person, so the values remain the same. The thought process is carried on in a similar way. In group decision making, high quality decisions can be taken up and increased acceptance, because more people are agreeing to such a decision, and so increased form of acceptance can be taken up. This is all about the group decision making, and all the topics have been covered for group behavior. Let us move on to another topic, that is conflict management. So when we talk about conflict, it can be defined as a process that begins when one party perceives that another party has negatively affected or is about to negatively affect something that the first party cares about. So the conflict is when there is one or more party to it, more than one party to it, and where there is a clear-cut perceived form of conflict that another party is trying to bring about hurdles in the goal achievement of the first party. Then it encompasses a wide range of conflicts that people experience in organizations, like incompatibility of goals. That is, say you assign a very easy goal to a very knowledgeable and experienced person, so that would not match, and there might arise a conflict on his part. Differences over interpretation of facts. The facts can mean different, can carry different meanings for different people. Disagreements based on behavioral expectations. So disagreements are bound to arise. So all these can be various forms of conflict in the organization. If we have to talk about the traditional view of conflict, it was a belief that all conflict is harmful and should be avoided. And the causes were given generally poor communication, lack of openness, and failure to respond to employee needs. But then the view has changed, and it has come up to a functional conflict view, which believes that conflict is somewhat positive for an organization, because it supports the goals of the group and improves its performance. So to some level, the conflict is positive, and still up to a point when it has a positive impact on the performance. But as soon as the level of conflict crosses a point and it becomes a negative impact, it gets negative impact on the performance, it forms the dysfunctional conflict. So conflict that hinders group performance is dysfunctional conflict. So when we talk about functional outcomes from conflict, what are the positives? We say it is increased group performance, improved quality of decisions, stimulation of creativity and innovation, encouragement of interest and curiosity, provision of a medium for problem solving, and creation of an environment for self-evaluation and change. So these are all the functional outcomes from conflict. So creation of functional conflict, the leader can actually reward dissent and punish conflict avoiders. So that is to be said, but it's very difficult to implement this. At the same time, what are the outcomes for dysfunctional conflict? First thing is development of discontent, that is because it's somewhat negatively, it has a negative impact on performance. So there is a lot of development of discontent amongst the group members, amongst the members of the organization. Reduced group effectiveness, people would work less and the timely completion of the task would become very difficult. Retarded communication, in a way people might pass on incomplete communication because of non-cooperation. Then it's reduced group cohesiveness, because of conflict it has an impact on the cohesiveness of the groups. Then infighting among group members overcomes group goals. So this is another outcome for a dysfunctional form of conflict. Let us now discuss what is a conflict process. When we talk about the conflict process, it has these various stages, wherein you can see here the first stage is latent conflict. Now this is a stage when you can see that in the organizations the reasons for these conflicts are already there, they are present, and which can form the basis for future conflict. Now there can be several reasons for it, maybe lack of communication, lack of resources, or interdependence in between the departments. So that forms the first stage, the latent conflict, where just the reasons and causes of conflict are present. There is a second stage, perceived conflict. This is the stage when you see that the parties to conflict have realize that the other party is trying to hinder their goals, and the parties to conflict are very well acknowledged that they have entered into a conflict. Then we have felt conflict. Felt conflict is a stage when you can see here that the people in conflict, they share certain emotional exchanges, such as maybe anxiety, the feeling of tension, aggression is there, and they have realized it, they have become aggressive. So all that, the emotional flow, that forms a felt conflict. The next stage is the manifest conflict. It is a stage when parties to conflict, they have actually exchanged the views in such a way where the other people around have started realizing that there is actually a conflict which might take a very serious form and can get carried off till maybe exchange of arguments, hot discussions, maybe violence. So that forms a manifest conflict. Now at this point the conflict reaches its highest level, and then is generally being referred to the management or right authorities in the organization, and is tried to be resolved. There are certain techniques of resolution which might be taken up, which we are going to discuss next in the next slides. So there can be two outcomes for this. One is that if the conflict is resolved in a proper way, where there are positive outcomes and the parties to conflict are very much satisfied that they have actually got a solution for the problem, then in such a situation when they are satisfied on this, the conflict gets resolved. But in another situation where the conflict is being suppressed, in such a situation it can lead to a further conflict which is negative in nature, and again forms the basis of the first stage, that is the latent conflict. So this is the entire conflict process which is being followed. Now, what are the various conflict handling intentions or techniques here? Let us see here, there are two dimensions. One is assertiveness, another is cooperativeness. So, when we talk of assertiveness, it ranges from low to high, and cooperativeness is ranges from again low to high and cooperative and cooperative. Wherein assertiveness means there is more concern for self and cooperativeness is more concern for others. Now there are five dimensions to it. You can see it very well that by ways of these arrows competing, the green arrow represents one party and blue is another party. So competing means there is a generally win-lose situation where one party is highly assertive and another is not that much assertive or tries to win over the other party, and the resultant is that one of them wins and that forms the competing or competition. So the resolution is generally one party wins over the others. Another is collaborating, wherein you can see that it is highly assertive and highly cooperative. In such a situation, generally the interests of both the parties are being met down together and both the parties are ready to, you know, they have got their share of interest. Then we have compromise, where you can see both the parties, they lose something and then they come to a common point of agreement. So it's a lose-lose situation where both the parties have to lose out their some share of interest and then come to a compromising point or to negotiate or maybe to come to a resolution. Then we have accommodating, where you would see that one party tries to lose some share of its and try to give the another party a higher share and benefit. So it's like more of sacrificing type of resolution. So one party is initiating and is ready to lose its own share. So that forms accommodating. We can also call it lose-win situation. And the last resolution can be avoidance, where you can see the two parties, they're being asked to move in different directions and not to any further talk on this issue, not to have any discussions on this issue. So that forms avoidance. So these are five possible ways by which the conflict can be resolved and can be taken care of. So conflict management techniques would actually, these techniques will help in problem solving. Clear goals will be there, expansion of resources, avoidance, smoothing, these are the all the points to be touched. And authoritative command, altering the human variable, altering the structural variables. So the techniques should actually aim at all these issues. And also conflict resolution techniques should also aim at better communication, bringing in outsiders, restructuring the organization, and appointing a devil's advocate, that is a person which can bring about the bad things and would focus on improvement. So that is all about the group behavior and conflict management. Thank you.